Welcome to 3Count Commentaries. This is your host, Mongo Slade. Today, we are going to be discussing an article from Michael Sidgwick called AEW's Huge FU to WWE and Why It Will Win. The subtitle is Tony Khan Took a Pile Driver on Dynamite, but it's Paul Levesque who needs to brace himself. This thing is five parts, and I only read one. And decided I needed to bring this to the people. This needs to be brought to the people. So let's get right into it. I don't even know what it's about, really. So we'll see. Something about Tony Khan not liking Triple H, or Triple H needs to, or WWE's going to take an L. That's pretty much what I'm getting from it. But it's a very venomous piece just from the first part. Let's see what we can get out of this. Paul, me and my friend Mark Levesque is a very defensive and petulant individual. When pressed about Jordan Grace's cameo at the Royal Rumble in January, Levesque, who told Brody Lee that he could make a New Japan Pro Wrestling excursion happen, but has failed to do so over the subsequent 5 years, rubbished the term Forbidden Door. He never fancied New Japan anyway. In 2015, when WWE tried to get in via Jushin Liger, Rocky Romero successfully struck the interpromotional deal between New Japan Pro Wrestling and Ring of Honor. This is probably some of that inside baseball I don't know that much about. But Jushin Liger did appear in NXT, so it is what it is. He says, quote, over at WrestleMania weekend, Levesque aimed a jab at in the direction of Will Ospreay, but was too gutless to name him. He was too gutless. Everybody knew to whom Levesque was referring when he said he isn't interested in signing wrestlers who apparently fear the grind. Ospreay wrestled for TNA last year purely because he fancied it and has spent the last several years trying to leave the Brit Rest scene in a state that didn't quite resemble utter disrepair. And after he'd long made it as a top star for New Japan, Ospreay did more grinding in his dynastic classic with Bryan Danielson than the average WWE wrestler does on TV in a month. He wrestled a 35-minute match with Bryan Danielson. 35 minutes. That was his, second match that week? He had two matches in a week. A WWE wrestler has like three or four matches a week. I mean, okay. Sure. I mean, if you say so, brother. Let's get back to this thing. Levesque was hardly going to say, I wanted him, but here's the thing. Despite this being the Paul Levesque era, it's starting to feel as if I'm not in charge of the budget. Well, he's not in charge of the budget, but WWE can spend money on talent if they want to. The question would be, what are they going to get in return for that talent? They spent money to get Jade. They spent money to get CM Punk. Now, CM Punk was one of those things where he didn't really have much of an way of competition between him. And it was either CM Punk goes to WWE or he goes back on his couch. It was one or the other, you know. But they spent the money to get him. They haven't spent the money to retain some of the talent that they've got yet as of this recording. There's still supposedly some wrestlers whose contracts are expiring, and WWE have not reassured those contracts yet. Let's get back into this thing. Did he have to be so nasty and spiteful about it? Was there subtext to that? Levesque cannot handle the idea that he isn't the sharpest mind in wrestling or the coolest guy on the scene. He will have to get used to the idea by the end of 2024 if current trends continue, or if he's not reckoning with that idea already. Levesque is currently enjoying himself, and greatly. He has reached his final form. He presides over WWE, just as everybody knew he wanted to do in late 1999. But is that truly the extent of what he wanted? I don't know. Are we about to do some mind reading? Because it feels like we're about to do some mind reading. And I don't like mind reading, dog. But whatever. Okay, I'm not going to read this part. This is just him giving some background over Triple H getting involved with Vince McMahon, getting in his ear. You know, the click stuff, creative. Then we get to what might be interesting. For a developmental league designed through the Performance Center to build WWE stars from scratch, by 2019, NXT sure looked like Pro Wrestling Guerrilla with a far bigger budget. 14 wrestlers appeared on the main TakeOver New York card, a show heralded as both the zenith of NXT and one of the greatest wrestling events ever promoted. Of that 14, just three could be described as WWE originals. Shayna Baszler and the Velveteen Dream had minimal experience before becoming the property of the Performance Center. Bianca Belair had none. The PC might as well have not existed in April 2019. Well, that might be a good point, but that's also a point that he's stealing from Dave Meltzer. Dave Meltzer is the one who made the suggestion that NXT was just PWG with a bigger budget, because a lot of the same talent went through there. Now, let's talk about this. The Performance Center opened in 2013. WWE has been doing developmental since the late 90s. But quite often, the developmental, quote-unquote, was basically they would go find people who are already in the business, and then they would send those people to Dory Funk Jr. or, you know, Deep South or whatever, and they would basically retrain them. On the off chance that they got like a Mark Henry, a guy that they really liked but had no experience, they would take a little bit longer with them. You know, Mark Henry did not have the benefit of, you know, an NXT or a Performance Center at the time. Yes, he went to the Funkin' Dojo, but and he was sent to the various developmental systems over time because he was not improving and his weight had gotten pretty crazy, but he wasn't improving fast. But Performance Center was not mostly people from scratch. It was mostly indie talent, which is what everybody said that they wanted, is they wanted WWE to be like a finishing school. They wanted to be, you did 3 or 4 years on the indies, maybe 10. And then once you were established, you had a reputation, you would go to WWE and they show you where the cameras were. And then you get a chance in NXT. The system changed when, you know, I think when Vince and all of those guys started taking over in the NIL system, you know, Nick Khan came in and they started bringing in athletes. That's when they really started focusing on building talent from scratch and not bringing in, you know, indie wrestlers. And you could tell that switch happened when they gutted NXT when Triple H got sick. They just decided, we're going to get rid of Karrion Kross and Io Shirai and Adam Cole because, and I know people love NXT, but it was a money pit. NXT never made a goddamn dime throughout the entire time. It was supposedly the best wrestling show on television. It was behind a paywall on the network and it wasn't making any money. They wasn't running too many buildings. They would run a building for TakeOver, but that was pretty much it. They mostly were guys hanging out in the studio. It's a studio show. So let's get back into this thing. I don't want to go into too deeply into NXT. He said, Levesque recruited the best talent from the indie scene when they came considerably cheaper because he very much enjoyed being sent fruit baskets by Reddit and being the guy who put the coolest and most critically acclaimed talents over. You take one look at that card and the idea that he wouldn't want to sign Will Ospreay is preposterous. Had New Japan Pro Wrestling not award Ospreay a contract after just one match, Levesque would have put the NXT title on Ospreay quicker than he moved on from China. Okay, it's not a question about whether he would have wanted to sign Will Ospreay. Of course he would want to sign Will Ospreay. Will Ospreay is an amazing talent in terms of athleticism. He's coming along in terms of psychology, but he's a tremendous physical specimen, you know, in terms of athleticism. But it doesn't matter how many stars Dave Meltzer wants to give him. When you look at Will Ospreay, he ain't making AEW any money. They just built an entire pay-per-view event, AEW Dynasty, around Will Ospreay versus Bryan Danielson, the dream match. They built the entire show around that. It was the first match announced. It drew less, not just than the previous pay-per-view, but also the pay-per-view before that. And you want to say, well, the pay-per-view before Dynasty was Revolution. Sting retired. Okay, so take that one out of the conversation. It's a bump because Sting retired. But it also drew less than World's End. It also drew less than, I don't care how many stars you give it. You can give it as many stars as you want. Oh, it was a 22-star match. Okay, great. You made less money than World's End, which I believe is a show that Will Ospreay didn't appear on, if I'm correct. He didn't wrestle on that show. He might have made an announcement on that show, but he didn't wrestle on that show. Okay, so that's what Triple H is talking. Triple H is in the business of business. He's not in the business of dream matches. And this is why I tell people all the time, NXT was a money pit. They did all that crazy shit over in NXT. It took forever for them to start making some money. It took forever, literally, before they could start selling out buildings. They really only did that stuff piggybacking off of WrestleMania and other big events. And then when they finally got to the point where they could do things on their own, you know, that's when Dynamite started kicking them in the ass with talent that weren't even nearly as good. People would much rather see Ali and Diamante than watch Matt Riddle and Finn Balor. This is paired out by the fact that AEW was kicking NXT in the balls every week. So don't give me any of this crap about how, you know, NXT was so great. It was just, that was the AEW of its time. It was the Ring of Honor of its time. It's the WCW, the ECW of its time. All these companies have their time, their moment in the sun, where they're different enough from WWE, and they become popular. Because WWE either sucks at the time, the creative is kind of lacking, or whatever the case may be. NXT had its time. But it also was created with a mission. The mission was not to be the third brand. The mission was not to be a super indie. The mission was to create the next WWE superstars. And it failed at that mission. And it failed at that mission so many times that Vince and Bruce Pritchard had to blow it the fuck up. They had to just go in there and destroy it. We would not have Tiffany Stratton, Brian Breaker, Trick Williams, and so many others if Triple H would have had his way. We wouldn't even have Bianca Belair if Triple H would have had his way. I know that some people really love Johnny Gargano and all those people. And I'm trying not to, you know, go on a rant about how much I hate NXT. Well, NXT at that time. But that is what it is. Let's get back to this article. He'd have signed Kazuchika Okada if it were up to him and AEW didn't exist to drive up the asking price. The counteroffer, WrestleMania, etc., obviously wasn't sufficient. Despite boasting inordinate cash reserves, WWE is playing a dirt cheap game and failing at it. At present, it doesn't matter. The WWE pull is too strong among fans. Nothing against the performer specifically. He has a great look, is funny, and has proved that he can go in the right spot. But it's very much a sign of the times that WWE has signed Tama Tonga from New Japan, where AEW has signed Ospreay and Okada, and the former is automatically going to become a bigger star. Yep. Because they brought in Tama Tonga for a purpose. The purpose was they wanted to do the Bloodline story. They wanted to continue doing that. So they brought in Tama Tonga, who they could use for that story. Kazuchika Okada was probably never going to WWE in any way because he's friends with the Elite. He's friends with these guys. It's the same ridiculous stuff about Kota Ibushi, you know? And there are some guys that were just never going to go to WWE. Kota Ibushi, you know, Okada, and a couple of others because they're friends with the Elite. I mean, trying to play coy, like, well, if they'd have offered Okada a lot of money, no, he was going to go work with his friends. Because that's what he left Japan for, to go work with his friends. You know, come on, let's be real about this. Let's go back to this article. Bigger star, yes, but by the end of 2024, Tony Khan is on trend to receive the smart vote. If you don't think that matters to Triple H, you'd be wrong. The smart vote. Sure. I'm pretty sure the one vote Triple H cares about is money going in the cash register and him being able to keep his job. Because guess what? Now he has people who are not related to him who are watching what he does. And if he's not good at it, he will be removed. The nepotism, and if he was involved with ousting Vince, he basically was cutting the branch that he sat on. Because the only reason he continued to have NXT all the time that he had it was because Vince was his father-in-law. Now he doesn't got that anymore. Nick Khan ain't his daddy-in-law, and Ari Emanuel definitely ain't his daddy-in-law. So it's in his best interest to produce talent and shows that the world will care about, that will make more money. So even if at one point in time he was infatuated with the smart vote, he can't be anymore. Because trying to cater to the whims of the fickle smart audience will have him ousted from his job. And there's no good reason why he wouldn't. Let's go. Triple H wrestled 25 minutes in every WrestleMania match he ever had because he thought you'd confuse a long match with a great one. He always wanted to be trendy. This is a man who groomed into the cool heel thing in the 90s and D-Generation X and launched his big heel turn by saying the word fuck rather a lot to Jim Ross. He later in his career designated himself the ass kicker. His match with the Ultimate Warrior was 25 minutes? It wasn't. His match with Owen Hart was 25 minutes? It wasn't. I understand these things sound great, you know, because when he got up to the top, he did start working longer matches, but that's because when you're somebody people pay to see, you do need to work a little bit longer, to a degree. Not if you're Goldberg or Brock or somebody like that, or Undertaker, where match people would be like, it's 15 minutes, that's fine. But Triple H, I can see why he would work, you know, 30-minute match. He probably felt like that he was that guy. And he wasn't. And sometimes that didn't quite work out. It probably would have been better if it was half the time. But what does it got to do with the smart audience? That's what I want to know. He says, Levesque built his reputation on signing hot free agents. It's one of the few things he beat Tony Khan to. For whatever reason, he can't get the best ones anymore. AEW is giving him the big fuck you at that game. And all he can do is spit his dummy out and throw his toys out of the pram. He literally wrote that. Is this some kind of English jabber? What is this crap? So does AEW win here? AEW wins by doing what AEW set out to do, to achieve from the beginning, to mount a respectable fight as a challenger brand and build its own TV-sized audience. AEW has already won. This cannot be overstated. And this isn't stated enough, but it runs deeper. I will say that. I will agree with that part. AEW has already achieved a certain level of success due to the fact that it's still on the air 5 years in, which is incredible. The fact that it's still been around as long as it has, especially when you had the pandemic occur for a year and a half. And really damaged, you know, pay-per-view businesses and ticket sales and all that kind of stuff. The fact that AEW survived that, big thumbs up. Let's get back into this thing. AEW wins by securing the exorbitant rights fee that will position it as the second most financially successful promotion in pro wrestling history. Levesque never did that with NXT, which in 2019 was paid pennies by a USA network that, desperate to retain a main roster brand in the third round of negotiations, did it the favor. Okay, AEW does not have that rights fee, by the way. That rights fee has not come yet. So I don't know why you would write that, because it did not come yet. But you are correct about NXT. But USA had tried to court NXT to television before. They did it. They didn't offer them a lot of money because NXT is a developmental brand. I mean, it is what it is. It's not a third brand. It's not Raw, SmackDown, blah, blah, blah. It's Raw and SmackDown. Then there's NXT below that. You know? And USA knew that. They're not stupid. Okay? They know that the same amount of resources are not put towards NXT as was put towards Raw and SmackDown. And they invested wisely, and they didn't want to do that because it was full of goddamn indie wrestlers that nobody was going to pay to see. And then they promptly got their shit kicked in as soon as Dynamite showed up, which had lower quality wrestlers, but more money. Funny how that worked out. AEW earned a rights fee with a from-scratch great product. Levesque's main roster product secured the Netflix deal, but all he had to do after a head start longer than his interminable wrestling matches was improve upon Vince McMahon's. Vince's main roster product was an atrocity, and yet it was so fail-proof that WWE announced the Fox deal on June 26, 2018, the same date on which SmackDown ratings fell to a low for the year. That episode, incidentally, featured the third and fourth non-finish WWE had booked across a 48-hour span. Who the hell remembers this crap? I don't know what the fuck he's talking about. I will say this, though. AEW earned a rights fee from its from-scratch great product. No. AEW earned a rights fee because of Kevin Riley, who was the friend of Tony Khan, and Kevin Riley worked in Warner Brothers Discovery. Isn't it suspicious that Kevin Riley does not work there anymore? And here we are trugging along with no new rights deal for AEW. Isn't that weird? Now, I fully believe that they'll get one, but he re-signed them pretty quickly, right? When they was on TV for less than a year, I think, and they got another renewal. And here he is gone. And it's taken a while to get the new rights deal done, huh? Funny how that worked out. Anyway, let's go. The bar Levesque had to clear, and he didn't even need to do that. Realistically, WWE was more than fine when it was awful, was buried deep into the core of the earth, just above Booker T at WrestleMania 19. AEW wins by actually forging successful relationships with prominent Japanese and Mexican companies. Levesque's long-held dream of global localization is a joke. NXT Japan and NXT Mexico aren't happening. They aren't wanted there. Arena Mexico will go apeshit to the level of a religious experience for the Blackpool Combat Club, but they don't want a watered-down version of what they like because it got the initials WWE attached to it. The Tokyo Dome received AEW's Bryan Danielson as a demigod, but they don't want NXT Japan. WWE has tested the waters for years, only to be told time and time again not to bother. Levesque also tried to make inroads into the United Kingdom. One of the most highly watched TV channels, ITV, launched a World of Sport reboot in the mid-2010s. That will not do. And thus, with Brit Rest booming, the NXT UK brand was launched. It was a dismal and, given its ruinous nature, cathartic failure. The weekly show was the most dry, uninspiring, bland, utterly irrelevant bore ever produced under the WWE banner. This is stretching the conceit somewhat, but if there's a potential superstar working what's left of the grass scene, that wrestler will inevitably make it to Rev Pro, which is now loosely associated with AEW, offering them a quicker way in. Let's pause right here, because I hear a lot of people talk about the Brit Rest scene, which I didn't know anything about, didn't care about. NXT UK popped up. Is NXT UK a failure? Well, yeah, it doesn't exist anymore. So yes, failure. It doesn't exist anymore. But let's see if the plan is to have wrestlers make more money. Why would they turn down the opportunity to make more money rather than work on the independents? Why would they turn down a more secure, steady paycheck to continue working independents? It seems like, you know, in this article, he's talking about how Triple H is being stingy with the money when it comes to Okada and Ospreay. But when they weren't being stingy with the money and they offered guys like Gunther and Jordan Devlin and Pete Dunne and Trent Seven, they offered them money because, you know, that's what you should want is wrestlers making more money. You call them sellouts. These are sellouts who killed the Brit wrestling scene. When now you're saying, well, you didn't offer the right amount of cash to Will Ospreay. It's like, wait a minute, what side are you on? Are you on the side of WWE should offer people what you think they're worth and kill the independents? Or should WWE not sign them and they should continue doing the grind on their own and likely making it nowhere? Because guess what? Everybody's goal is to make as much money as possible. Even if their goal is not WrestleMania, it is to make the most money as possible. And these guys would not have jumped ship to WWE or NXT UK if they were making a living on the independents in Britain. They made the right decision for their families, at least the decision that was made at the time. Maybe if AEW existed, they would have done that. But it didn't exist. So they made the decision in 2016, 2017 that they could make, which is WWE is willing to invest in Europe and invest in European talent. If you're one of the best in terms of European talent, you want to be on a WWE product. Why wouldn't you? I mean, there's just no good reason why you wouldn't want to be there. Let's continue. AEW wins by proving that you don't need to stuff an international legend into a performance center locker for several years so that they can learn the dark arts of locating a camera with a glowing red light on it. One day, a reckoning will come for that facility. The presentational difference between WWE Shinsuke Nakamura and AEW's Kazuchika Okada is staggering, and the PC has produced, from scratch, less than a handful of names that are given priority when the plans for WrestleMania are first drawn up. Well, again, that part of that is because NXT stifled the growth of a lot of NXT talents by pushing a number of indie wrestlers. And it's going to take a while. But when you see Tiffany Stratton, and you see Trick Williams, and now you're seeing Bron Breakker, you're going to start seeing some people. Kiana James, you're going to start seeing some people come out of there now. You know? Because Vince cleared the way. He gave NXT a fucking enema and got rid of all these people who seem to be in NXT forever and not giving an opportunity to nobody else. Now that's starting to change. Now let's talk about Kazuchika Okada and Shinsuke Nakamura. Well, for starters, Shinsuke Nakamura has been in WWE since 2016. So, of course, his presentation is not going to be the same. He's been there for 6 years already. Okada's fairly new. Okada is friends with the bosses, the EVPs. You know, Shinsuke Nakamura is not. Okada is still relatively in his physical prime. Shinsuke Nakamura is not. But more importantly, because Nakamura has been in WWE for a while already, he's already wrestled in main events. He's won the Royal Rumble. He's won championships. He has wrestled for the main championship several times. He was in a big match at WrestleMania, in his first WrestleMania, by the by. So you're talking about a guy who's well established in the WWE's mid-card, upper lower mid-card to a degree, versus somebody who's pretty much spanked brand new from AEW. How about we compare Shinsuke Nakamura to Kota Ibushi? How about that? Okay, what is the presentation of Kota Ibushi? There is no presentation of Kota Ibushi because he's injured, for starters. But what was his presentation before that? Was it top-notch stellar? No, it wasn't. Kota Ibushi, nothing in AEW. Nothing. Nothing, nobody. So we can play that game, too, if that's what you want to do. But I don't want to do that. I don't care about this. Let's go back into this thing. AEW wins by outclassing the TakeOver brand with this string of seminal, all-time great pay-per-views. Levesque was, as he should have been, proud of the 2015 to 2019 run. With it, he earned what had eluded him throughout his career, your admiration. It has dated badly in a lot of respects, and the highs of AEW's big shows are virtually unprecedented. Huh! The highs are virtually unprecedented. Oh, my goodness. How deep in the bubble is this guy? Oh, Jesus Christ. AEW isn't at its strongest yet. But if its form of pay-per-views continues through 2024, Tony Khan will be gifted the fruit basket. WWE is red hot. AEW is cold. But Tony Khan beat Paul Levesque at the game Levesque originally tried to play. Perhaps Levesque wants to play a different game now. Perhaps he's happy being on top as the booker and mascot of a more broad main roster product. But here's the thing. Despite what he says, Triple H wants you and your friend Mark to think he's neat. Ask yourself why he's so rattled. And that is the end of this thing. Triple H is rattled because he wanted to play the game of signing a bunch of free agents and Tony Khan is beating him to doing so. And Tony Khan has the heart of the Smarks, which Triple H wants. And look, when it comes to the heart of the Smarks, we already know these people are incredibly fickle. They were on Triple H's jock. Then they jumped ship immediately to Tony Khan, and they rode him for a while. Now they're jumping back onto Triple H's jock. This is what they do, man. They jump back and forth. They're bandwagon hopping. You know, they're the hardest of the hardcores, but at the same time, they're the most fickle fans in the world. And that's why they love New Japan. So many of these guys talk about how great New Japan is. New Japan can still barely do 6,000 people in a building in the United States. Of all the fans you see, all the cage match ratings that you give these people, these 5 stars that you give New Japan's product, they still cannot penetrate the United States and make a ton of money over here. They just can't. That's why they partnered up with AEW. Because they can't get over here on their own. And guess what? If the Smarks mattered, New Japan would be the second biggest pro wrestling company in the world. AEW would not have had a space to enter if New Japan, with all of the Smarks that supported it for so many years, would have been enough. The Smarks are never enough. If you think Triple H cares more about being Booker of the Year and 5 stars on Cage Match or whatever the fuck, than keeping his job, then I don't know where you get that from. I don't see that that's his concern. He has a different vision than Vince. It was simple. Triple H saw if you were bubbling on the independents, he would bring you in and see what you got. Give you an opportunity in the big leagues. He didn't really care too much about age. So you would see him signing 38-year-old Taya Valkyrie to an NXT developmental contract, which makes no sense. Vince is saying, look, I gave you this budget to bring me new young stars, and you're bringing me Taya Valkyrie, Keith Lee, Matt Riddle, Damian Priest, all these people who are 36, 38 years old. I can't do anything with these people. He blew it up, and now we got Trick Williams and Tiffany Stratton and Bron Breakker, and some other people bubbling up in NXT who are young talents, who are in their early to mid-20s. I will never forget that Bianca Belair languished in NXT, being behind Kairi Sane and Shayna Baszler and other... I mean, look, no diss to them, but Bianca Belair clearly was a bigger star and had more potential than Shayna Baszler, who was almost 40 at the time of what that we're talking about here. As soon as Bianca Belair is brought up to the main roster, Vince puts the rocket to her. Now she's on everything. All right? Is that a surprise? That, you know, once Vince clears out NXT, we start getting more young talent that was brought, that was the point of NXT in the first place. So sure, Triple H does like to cater to the Smarks, which is a problem. That's always been his weakness, because the Smarks are fickle and they want the same thing over and over and over again. That's why all the guys who are in AEW are 40-year-old ROH guys. That's why there should be no reason why you should have a spank brand new company and your top guys are like Roderick Strong, Samoa Joe. Look, I love Samoa Joe, but come on. Let's be real about this thing. But hey, have at it. Have your fun. You know, Tony Khan is beating Triple H in some regards. That's absolutely true. In other regards, he's not doing so well. But ultimately, the point of business is to make money. And Tony Khan, I don't think he's making money. But let me know what you guys think. Like, share, subscribe. I'll talk to you guys later. Peace out. Bongo Slate.
Best house ever, Drew Daddy.